fees bill would establish this state broadband office and plan. I want to thank Representative Ashby as well as Speaker Phelan for their efforts to move this legislation through the Texas House of Representatives. I also want to thank Senator Robert Nichols, whose district we are in right now, who could not be here today, for his leadership in the Texas Senate to establish a state broadband office and plan. I look forward to working with all of them as well as all the members in the Texas House and Senate to expand broadband access in Texas and to ensure that this session we close the digital divide. I'll pass it to Speaker Phelan.
Thank you, Governor. First of all, I want to thank you, Dwayne, for having us here today. When I think of Hampshire Finette, I think about a family. A family's been through a lot over the last few years. A devastating fire, Harvey, Imelda. I don't go through this community without thinking about Trevor Shoshan and the loss of his life. And his father and grandfather are good friends of mine, so this community's been through a lot. And so I thought, what better spot to have an announcement that is future thinking and vibrant and exciting than House Bill 5 and the work that my colleague, Representative Ashby's worked on. Governor, thank you for being here in Southeast Texas again. You're welcome to register as a voter here. You're here so often. Thank you for making it an emergency item. And it's the reason that I made it House Bill 5 a low bill number to show for all of Texas. And Representative Ashby took this task on over a year ago. And you would think something with such support would be easy to do. And it's even more pressure to get it right because there are differing ideas, opinion on technology and how we move forward and different private entities that may want to move into this space. And we got to think about not just 2 years, 4 years, but 10 years from now. And Trent can go into the details of all that. But trying to build very broad support for broadband is much more difficult than it seems. He's done an excellent job. And this bill is out of committee. It will be on the House floor soon. This is about connectivity and reliability. And we did not, you can't underscore how important that is coming out of COVID and realizing that digital learning is probably here to stay. Distance learning is here to stay. Telehealth is here to stay. But we have to bridge that divide, that digital divide. And it's not just rural Texas. It's also areas of urban Texas that have a divide. And Representative Ashby can get into the mapping aspect of it. He's done it about all Texans. So we're coming together on House Bill 5. I feel great about it. We have opportunities to fund this. This isn't just an idea. It was avenues to fund this legislation. There's federal dollars out there. Came in. Next week, House Bill 2000 and HJR 2, which is called the SURF, the State Utility Reliability Fund. It's much like the SWIFT fund that my predecessor, Alan Ritter, who represented this area we're standing right now, he passed in 2013, dealing with water, freshwater, and wastewater supply projects. The SURF is just like that, a revolving loan program that will fund modernization and weatherization of utility, generation and transmission, because we need that after the storm we just experienced a month ago, but also broadband. Right now, it's a $2 billion ask out of the ESF, or the Rainy Day Fund, to help build out that infrastructure. That bill, HJR 2, will go before the voters next November to be approved. But there's also federal dollars. There's also the CARES Act 3, Restore America, that we're going through the fine print to decide whether or not we can spend that on this, but I think we can spend some of those funds on broadband. So this isn't just an idea without funding. The funding's there as well. So again, thank you, Governor Abbott, for being here in Southeast Texas again, and my colleague Trent Ashby for his really Herculean efforts on this bill. And I feel like it's going to have broad bipartisan support, and we will get this to the governor's desk sooner rather than later. Representative Ashby?
Well, thank you, Speaker Phelan, and first off, Dr. Augustine, thank you for hosting us here in Hampshire Finette today. It's great to be back in the schoolhouse. Unfortunately, I don't have to take a test today, but it's wonderful to be here, and thank you for your hospitality. session. But as you have rightly said in making this an emergency item for the legislature, this is right up at the top of the list. And of course, to my speaker, Speaker Dave Phelan, I remember here a few months ago when we talked about this issue of connectivity, hiding in our areas for rural Texas, but really, as he said, this is an issue for all Texans. And one of the great things about House Bill 5 is that no matter what zip code you live in, whether you're in the most urban of urban inner city or whether you're in the most far remote places in rural Texas, this bill is going to move Texas into the 21st century in a big way. It's a transformational piece of legislation. And one of the things, as the governor said, and he is so right, is that connectivity and access to the internet, really broadband internet, it is no longer a luxury. It is absolutely a necessity. And COVID-19 has really laid bare the problems that persist for those that either don't have the resources to subscribe to internet services or in across rural Texas, those that don't even have access to it. And so what we've tried to do with this piece of legislation, in working in concert, very importantly, with my senator, our Senator Robert Nichols, who I want to publicly thank for his commitment to this as well, is we have moved SB 5 and HB 5 simultaneously working together and collectively to recognize that we need a state broadband office, as the governor said. This is a priority. We need someone man in the clock 24 hours a day in office here in the state of Texas and our government that really is pushing every day to expand the capability for our citizenry to have access to this critical technology. Secondly, in the bill, we also call upon that office within 12 months of enactment to roll out our statewide broadband plan. As it takes to be successful in any schoolhouse or business, you got to have a plan. And so we are calling upon the state to work with the experts in this arena, the stakeholders, the citizenry of Texas, to come up with a plan that works for Texas. And so we will have a statewide broadband plan for our beloved state. The speaker talked about mapping. That is a critical component of this bill. You know, it doesn't do a lot of good to have it if you don't know where we have connectivity issues and where we don't. And so we need to be able to drill down not just to the census block, as the federal government historically has done, but down to the household level. We want to know who in the state of Texas has access to broadband and who doesn't. And this bill requires that. And the last thing is the most important part, potentially, is the funding aspect of this. And that is what the speaker alluded to. We believe between our federal partnership in Washington and, of course, with the commitment of the state of Texas, that there will be sufficient funding to not just enact the plan, but to move Texas forward in a giant way. And so we're really excited about the legislation that's being debated. Last week it was passed out of the State Affairs Committee unanimously. And let me end with this. Broadband access is not a Republican or Democrat issue. This is a Texan issue. And so we have worked very hard to make sure that all walks of life, all people, all legislators, and all stakeholders have had a seat at the table to make sure that we get this right. And so I'm very pleased with the work that's been done today. And just again, want to thank the leadership and the clear vision that has been put on display by our Governor Greg Abbott, as well as our Speaker Dave Phelan. So thank you for having me today.
Thank you, Representative Ashby, and we will take a few questions. Yes.
We see, especially in this region, some of our Council of Governments already taking the next steps to bring broadband to their area, specifically here in East Texas. How would this plan work with communities that already have their own broadband plan?
I'll answer part of that and then turn it over to Representative Ashby and Speaker Phelan. But you mentioned one thing that is so essential to this process, and that is all of our communities working in collaboration with the state. This can't be one state process that we just push into the local communities, but having those local communities do what you're talking about doing, which is working in the vanguard, making sure they're working to get it implemented already. This will work hand in glove at the state level with the local level, and the local participants are essential if we are going to be able to successfully get to every end user in their region. So we applaud and appreciate the activity at the local level.
And the governor hit the nail on the head. He's exactly right. This bill encourages the collaboration between local, statewide broadband office. And I'm going to use the Southeast Texas Regional Planning Commission and my COG just north of here, the Deepest Texas COG, as an example, because they both are working on regional plans to bring broadband access to their residents. And so in the bill, we prioritize on a regional level those groups such as the COGs that are bringing forward plans that make sense for that region. And so those plans, frankly, will have priority status in terms of funding that's available to help build out the broadband infrastructure. But the governor's exactly right. We are incentivizing and highly encouraging regional partnerships in collaboration with the state to bring broadband access to all Texans.
And I'll just add that, Caitlin, you reported extensively on the flood infrastructure fund that we worked on last session and that Representative Ashby supported and the governor signed. It's the same concept. We're going to regionalize, promote cooperation. That's what this office is all about. We're not trying to duplicate services. We're just trying to enhance them and promote them. So I see a pretty seamless transition in that. So.
Go ahead. Before the pandemic, increasing access to broadband we knew was important, but the pandemic turned it into something that was extremely urgent. I mean, look at what has happened with schools, and schools would not have been capable of providing education to students without broadband access, and because of lack of broadband access to some homes, some students have not been able to keep up with their peers. The same thing happened with so many businesses. So many businesses were shut down for periods of time, but others were able to thrive because they did have broadband access and they were able to sell their goods and services over the internet. And we saw the same thing with regard to healthcare because people were in their homes, they couldn't get out, and some doctor offices were not open, but those that did have broadband access were able to access healthcare. But candidly, on the healthcare side, it's even more phenomenal than that. I was talking with leaders at some of the premier hospitals in the entire world, at the Houston Medical Center, talking about how they would be able to provide ICU services to people in the northern reaches of the panhandle. And so the transformative solutions that will be able to be provided through broadband access will be phenomenal and game-changing for the state of Texas. But the last point I will make, and that is going back to something I said during my remarks, and that is, as much as we have begun to plan for this, we still see almost 900,000 people in the state of Texas without access to it. And hence, we all agree. And when I say we all, I'm talking about more than just the three of us up here. I'm speaking on behalf of both everyone in the House and Senate because this does have strong bipartisan support. We all agree that we must close that digital divide and provide broadband access to everybody in the entire state.
Let me add to that. House Bill 4 is the telehealth bill, another priority of the House. That's up in committee this week in public health. So I expect that to be on the House floor, hopefully after Easter, along with broadband. And we're about to expand a suite of services for all Texans, whether it's telemedicine or mental health, you name it. We're going to expand a suite of services. But it doesn't work in areas that don't have broadband. So it all dovetails very nicely. The pandemic obviously put a highlighter on all this. And again, it's a priority legislation of the House, Senate, and the governor, and I expect to get it done before May.
Very good. Other questions? Yes.
I guess in more practical matters, does this come down to encouraging these broadband providers into extending their own infrastructures, whether it be Spectrum or AT&T or whoever? Because there's cities around here that have very little access other than schools.
Right. The short answer is yes. However, a more detailed answer can be provided by Representative Ashby.
Right. And so, yes, I mean, ultimately, to really make this bill work, you've got to have our internet service providers that are building out the network that's going to be required to bring broadband access to our fellow Texans. And again, what works in Hampshire Finette may not be exactly the type of technology that works, say, in Colmanale. And so the beauty about this bill is whether it's cable, whether it's TV or satellite, whether it's our rural electric co-ops or our rural telephone companies, it is a technology agnostic bill to where really, truly, whatever works for that area is going to be ultimately the type of service that is provided. state. But the other thing I would point out is that both between the state funding that the speaker alluded to, as well as funding that's available specifically through the Rural Digital Opportunity Fund, or RDOF, as we call it at the federal level, those are the funds that help incentivize the build-out and the creation of broadband services, particularly into the rural parts of the state. And those are the dollars that I think ultimately will help this effort be successful.
Two more questions?
Go ahead.
Speaker Phelan, you mentioned the Flood Infrastructure Fund. How are the conversations this time around going back to lawmakers and say, let's take some more money out of the Rainy Day Fund for a different statewide opportunity? How are the conversations different this time versus the last time?
They're similar. The comptroller will tell you that there's actually a kind of cap on the Rainy Day Fund. At some point, money spills out of the Rainy Day Fund into GR if we have too much. But as he visits with creditors who rate the state of Texas as a AAA rating, which we are right now, and I'm very grateful for that, they will tell him, you need to use some of that money for infrastructure. And right now, where I believe in transfer appropriations, I'm not, but I believe it's over 10, getting closer to $11 billion Rainy Day Fund.
That's correct.
And the comptroller seems to think about somewhere north of $7 billion is a good amount to have in there. So we have, just like last session, we have some room there to invest that. And these credit agencies, who are very important in how we finance projects here in Texas, will tell you, if you're going to use it for anything, use it for infrastructure. And this is infrastructure. So whether or not we use the Rainy Day Fund at the end of the day, or we go through the fine print of the Restore America Act, CARES 3, and we decided to use some of that money, that remains to be seen. But using money for a one-time loan, revolving loan program like we did with SWIFT in 2013, had robust support, like we did with the Flood Infrastructure Fund in 2019, unanimous coming out of the House, unanimous coming out of the Senate. I think we can do that again with the SURF. But again, there are federal dollars through another fund that came in through 2020 that is another entirely different avenue for Texas. So I do feel like there's support there, and that bill will be on the floor not this week, but next week. So we'll find out what the temperature is on the House floor.
Last question.
Governor Abbott, thank you for addressing the broadband access. I just wanted to see if maybe you could touch on the situation at the southern border. If you could briefly make a quick remark on that and your concerns that you might have, whether it's COVID or unrelated COVID.
What's happening on the Texas border is nothing short of a human catastrophe. And it's a man-made catastrophe by the Biden administration's decision to have open border policies. We're having so many children who are in these detention centers, and it's very important for the public to know that these detention centers are over capacity, which means the Biden administration is not in compliance with federal law with regard to detaining these young children. On top of that, because they are young children, no young child travels the course of Mexico to get to and across our border without the assistance of cartels, and oftentimes that involves human trafficking. And so I think it's horrific that these young children are being enticed into human trafficking with Lord knows what may be happening to them along the way. I will tell you, the Secretary Mayorkas himself said that not only is it a dangerous trek, but he also said it's a trek where far too many children do not make it there safely. And then lastly, is the situation concerning the pandemic and the spread of COVID. Because in detention facilities, for the Springs, as well as Midland, and maybe other places, the positivity rate, there's more than 10% of the children in those facilities have tested positive for COVID. And so they are being handled appropriately, I'm told. But what is happening to the adults that have been exposed to those children who have COVID? Are those adults going into Midland or into Carrizo Springs or to other urban or suburban settings spreading COVID? Those are questions we've asked of the Biden administration. They have not answered, and we're very concerned about the potential spread of COVID because of the way that the Biden administration has shown that they are incapable of dealing with the situation.
Thank you all for coming.